Web development can be really confusing, and you can be tired of trying to follow all of the latest trends. Look no further, I got you covered. In this video, I will be covering different rendering patterns, metaframeworks, and the different solutions they offer. So let's check it out. First thing first, what are rendering patterns? Rendering pattern is the name used to reference the way a certain framework generates HTML to serve to the user. That's all. And are different ways to get that done, and that is the important bit. Over the years, the way that we build websites and applications has changed and evolved, and new patterns has arisen. But why are there so many rendering patterns and so many different solutions? The number of different rendering patterns is due to the many different requirements and technologies available that allow you to build different solutions. There are many different factors to create or use a pattern. One example is related with SEO or maybe optimization, or what type of application are you building. It's way different to create an internal tool like a dashboard or a user-facing application or just a content page. The main problem with these many different patterns is that you have to choose one, right? So how to choose a rendering pattern for your solution? The actual answer is it depends, and obviously you need to at least check 3 or 4 points to be able to choose one. Performance, you need to consider the performance and where are you willing to spend more time. Maybe you are willing to spend more time building but serving fast, or all the way around. What are your requirements in terms of search engine optimization? Do you need SEO really top-notch, or you just are building a tool then maybe it's not discoverable? And think about the scalability. You need to think about the future growth of your application. So what patterns are there? First of all, and the OG of everything, is the static site. The web started as a static site, set of HTML files first, and then we had CSS and JavaScript and images. You can build a site with just getting together a set of static files, putting in some bucket like S3 or something like that, and done. It will be enough for a landing page, for example. There are tools already do this that offer certain improvements in terms of DX, like UO, 11T, Jekyll, or even you can just throw something to GitHub and use GitHub page. But this is not scalable, right? So the web evolves and create another pattern, the MPA, the multi-page application pattern. This was the solution to add dynamism into the static pattern. The idea was to allow the servers to generate the HTML output based on external variables. For example, you can use the user session, the database, or any other aspect of the application to generate dynamic content for the user. This was really popular on the first days of the web, and so basically this is using a server-side code to generate the HTML. Frameworks that do this, there are many. The more popular are Laravel, Rails, Django, but with the rise of other technologies, there was a problem. The MPA basically means that you have a full rendering every time you change route. The entire page refresh. So there is no way to keep the state of the page, because you will need to send all of the state of the page back to the server. So when you go back to the page, the server will retrieve all of that and regenerate the entire HTML, so full refresh. How you solve that? The solution for that was the ever glorious SPA, the single page application pattern. I think that most of the current web developers know this pattern and work with this pattern. This is the rise of the JavaScript frameworks. We had Backbone, Ember, Angular, the original one, and React, and more like that. But that was the OG on the SPA. The idea here is that allowing the JavaScript to handle the entire state of the application and handle the rendering of the application. So basically, in the server, you create an empty HTML file with a bunch of JavaScript, and then the client will download all of that JavaScript, and that JavaScript will take care of recreating the DOM. The downside of this approach is that it's slow. There is a lot of blocking aspect of loading all of that JavaScript. You're shipping an empty shell there is no SEO at all. So you basically have the loading spinner hell. And so what solution was proposed here? So server-side rendering. It's kind of going back a bit to the MPA pattern, but this is a bit different. The idea here is that the initial render only is generated in the server and ships an entire set of HTML with some basic state into it. So the first render and load of the application is really, really fast. But at this point, the entire JavaScript set will take over. So after all of this HTML and JavaScript lands into the client, the JavaScript client will take over in a process known as iteration. Popular frameworks do this, like Next, Nuxt, Gatsby, and more. But there is a problem with SSR. Even though the initial render is really fast, you still need to wait for the JavaScript to trigger, to load, and to execute. So there is a gap between the initial render and the initial moment when the application is actually usable. Another pattern that arises almost in the same time is SSG, the static site generator. This is basically a way to use NiceDX to build your application, consume data, but ship static HTML as the first pattern. The king here was, or it's still, Gatsby. It basically allows you to use React in this case to set up the entire application, use the NiceDX tools, use fast refresh and all of that. And then in build time, Gatsby or similar frameworks will traverse the entire application and spit out HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. And that is the thing that you will ship to the bucket and cloud from or something like that. The problem with that is that the build times can be awful. If you have a big, big page with a lot of content, you can spend more than 5 minutes just building, and you will need to reveal the site every time you change something. So that's not good. That generates another solution, the incremental static regeneration, ISR. The idea, this approach is to solve the problem of SSG. It allows you to build an entire site, deploy it, and then regenerate or reveal pieces of the site based on some circumstances like invalidating certain cache. But ISR is not supported by every framework nor every host. Vercel for sure support ISR out of the box for Next. SSR, SSG, and ISR use iteration. This idea that some pieces are generated in the server, but then the client JavaScript will take over and continue from there. The problem with these patterns is that in the first load, there is a gap where the application can be unusable. For example, the application renders a set of buttons and models and forms, etc., but all of that are handled by JavaScript. In the moment between the first load and JavaScript start executing, if you click that button, the buttons will do nothing because there is no event listener still attached. A solution arises again, the partial iteration. The idea here is to solve this problem by setting parts of the application to be iterated and other not. So there will be lazy loading JavaScript to hydrate that pieces. But you can take that approach further and deeper. And that is the Iceland architecture approach that is really popularized again by Astro, aims to prevent JavaScript takes over the entire application and only perform in very well-defined pieces of the application. The idea is to isolate the pieces that require JavaScript, and even through Astro, you can use different frameworks to build different pieces of the application. And last but not least, resumability. This is probably the most promising of all of these patterns and is proposed by Quick. The idea here is to completely avoid iteration by rendering the entire site on the server, but instead of restarting the state on the client when the client takes over, the idea is to resume the state wherever the server left. The perfect analogy here is a virtual machine. If you use a virtual machine before, you know that you can pause the virtual machine, save that into some external storage, take that external storage into another computer, put it in the computer, and continue at the same place where you left the virtual machine. That is the same idea. Quick have some clever ways to do this. Be sure to check that out. Another advantage of the resumability pattern is that it can help you minifying the amount of data that runs through the network, resulting in faster loading times. This is because the rendering process can resume from where it was left off on the server. For example, if the server can fetch all of the data and render till certain point, and then when it's go to the client will not start fetching again from the start. It will continue in the same place. So, summary, conclusion. There are many different rendering patterns and are an essential part of the web. The web is taking over to different directions at this point. There are many promising solutions. Next.js, QuickCity, SolidStar, SvelteKit, Nuxt are offering new ways to solve these problems by adding a nice DX on top. Choosing one of these patterns depends on different variables. One of them is how knowledge are you with the framework that offers the pattern, or the requirements of the SEO, or the different performance requirements your application have. It's important to understand the pros and cons of each of these patterns to make an informed decision. Go ahead, pick one that suits you, choose the framework of your choice, and build amazing applications. If you got something from this video, click the like button and subscribe to the channel. That will help a lot. YouTube is a perfect recommendation machine, and they think that this video will like you. So I'm pretty sure it will be good. So check that. See you later.